Thank you and welcome back for the second lecture. So I will start basically from the point where I stopped on Tuesday. So we started to see the topological classification for dimensional SUN gauge theories. And in this case, the topology of the gauge configurations is given in terms of the winding number, the topological charge, which is the integral of the topological charge density. We already discussed that the homotopy group is the pi 3 of SU3, which or SUN, which is equivalent to the pi 3 of SU2. And that the GG dual, which is the topological charge density, also in this case, the total divergence of a current, and not, which is not gauge invariant. Anyway, it is also in this case a total derivative, I mean, a sort of total derivative, which classically is irrelevant, but it's not irrelevant from the quantum mechanical point of view. And the reason is that in the Patti integral, you have gauge configurations with a finite action, which are the minima of the classical action over each topological sector, which give a finite contribution. So you have configurations with a non-trivial topological charge, and the classical configurations, the minima over each topological sector, are either self-dual and they correspond to instantons, or anti-self-dual configurations and they correspond to anti-instantons with a topological charge which is negative. Okay, so this is the reason why we have non-trivial effects from the insertion of this topological term theta. And everything up to now is completely analogous to the other system that we analyzed, the quantum mechanical system, and also the abelian gauge theory two dimensions. Now, in this case, we have to say, okay, also in the case of two-dimensional gauge theories, of course, but in this case in particular, one difference comes from the presence of dynamical fermions, which enter the game in a non-trivial way. And how the fermions enter the game is essentially related to the Atiyah-Singer index theorem and to the Axial anomaly equation, which are also, of course, interrelated among themselves. So the index theorem tells you that the topological charge of a given gauge configuration equals the index of the Dirac operator of this slash. Okay, where the index is defined as the difference between the number of zero modes with a left-handed chirality or right-handed chirality. Okay, and of course, the dependence on the gauge configuration comes out because the slash operator is filled with the covariant derivative, so it brings information about the gauge field, the underlying gauge field, which in this case is treated as a background field on which the fermion fields propagate. And this difference in the number of left-handed and right-handed zero modes can be written as the trace of the gamma phi operator, where here the trace must be interpreted as a trace taken. I mean, the correct interpretation of the trace, because of course, trivially, the trace of gamma phi is zero, but the correct way to interpret this trace of gamma phi is to make the sum over, and to write this as a sum over the eigen modes of the slash operator, so as a sum over all the eigenvalues lambda of the Dirac operator of C bar lambda times gamma phi times the lambda. And from the property that for a continuum slash operator, gamma 5 times the eigenvector makes is proportional, is equal, proportional apart from a constant to the eigenmode of minus lambda. And which is also orthogonal to the eigenmode of eigenvalue lambda, then you see that the only contribution to this sum, which is a way of rewriting the trace, comes from eigenvectors which have lambda equals zero. So you can say that only lambda equals zero contribute. So and the contribution from left-handed and right-handed eigenmodes is opposite, comes from a minus sign. And the minus sign is because gamma they are eigenvectors also for gamma 5 with the plus or minus 1, depending on whether they are left-handed or right-handed. And so this is why you can rewrite the index as a trace over gamma 5. And I stress this because writing the topological chart as the trace of gamma 5 is a way of computing the topological chart on the lattice. So this is why I spent some time on this. Well, the content of the index theorem is equivalent to the content of the axial anomaly, which tells you that the divergence of the axial current, axial single current, which is sum over the light flavors of psi bar gamma mu gamma phi psi, which in the case of massless fermions is from the classical point of view is a conserved current, but at the quantum level it takes an anomaly, and the anomaly equation, which is x at all perturbative orders, so it's a non-perturbative relation, tells you that the divergence of the mu 5 is equal to 2 times the number of light flavors times the topological charge density. Now, one way to demonstrate the axial anomaly equation is to consider how an axial rotation, like the one that I show here, acts on the measure over the fermion fields in the path integral. And so you can prove that if you rotate the fermion fields as follows, so according to a singlet axial rotation, it is like changing the value of the topological parameter theta, which I introduced before, so which is the, sorry, I go back 2 slides, it is the parameter entering the functional integral at non-zero theta. It is like rotating the theta term, translating it by minus 2 alpha, where alpha is the angle of the axial rotation. So this is one way to prove the axial anomaly, actually. And of course, as you do this, you can change the theta term. But on the other side, in case you have a mass term in your theory, so if the fermion is massive, that means that the massive term gets a complex space, because in that case, this is not a symmetry of the classical action, and the mass term gets a complex space. So there are several consequences of this relation that we will analyze later on. Okay, but this is why dynamical fermions play a non-trivial game in QCD and in the context of theta dependence. Now, we can make the same considerations that we already did for the quantum mechanical example. I mean, we cannot perform numerical simulations directly at non-zero theta because the action becomes complex. So you, but we can think of performing an analysis of theta dependence, analyzing the coefficients of the Taylor expansion in series of theta of the free energy density, which becomes the vacuum energy if you are at zero temperature. Okay, so the expansion is the same as in the quantum mechanical example. I mean, you can prove also in this case that the coefficients of the expansion are related to the cumulants of the topological charge distribution, to the connected cumulants of the topological charge distribution as follows. And this is a standard parametrization of this series for the theta dependence around theta equals zero, where the first coefficient, chi, is the second cumulant. It is the what is called the topological susceptibility, which is the second cumulant divided by the four volume. And then this is a way, these terms in the square brackets, is a way to parameterize the deviations from a purely quadratic behavior, which are parametrized in terms of these coefficients, B2, B4, and so on, which in some sense are a measure of how your topological charge distribution deviates from a purely Gaussian distribution. Okay, if these corrections are zero, it means that just the second cumulant of the distribution is non-zero and all the other ones are exactly zero, which is what you have for a Gaussian distribution. Now, of course, in this case, this probability distribution is something that we don't know. It's a non-perturbative property of QCD that we would like to compute by lattice simulations. However, before going to actual lattice simulations, I mean to the lattice techniques that we can use to study this kind of observables, it is interesting to review what do we expect. I mean, well, because we have several analytical expectations that we would like to test by lattice simulations. So it is interesting to review what are these expectations. So first of all, I mean, what is the effect of the interplay with the light fermions? Now, first of all, if you have exactly massless quarks in the theory, then the effect of an axial rotation is just to change the value of theta. I mean, you don't have any mass term which gets a complex phase. So in this way, basically, you can think of rotating the theta away. Okay, so we expect that actually your theory does not have any theta dependence, or that the theta dependence is trivial. There is an intuitive understanding of this. I mean, why in the presence of massless fermions, theta dependence is actually trivial? If you think of the partition function in the presence of fermions, the presence of the fermions is encoded in the fermion determinant. Okay, and now, if you go back to the index theorem, we see that a non-zero topological charge implies that you must have some zero eigenvalue of the Dirac operator, because n plus minus n minus is different from zero, so there is some zero mode on this background field. But now a zero mode, if the fermion mass is exactly equal to zero, means that the determinant vanishes, and so such a configuration has zero weight in the path integral. So basically that means that that means that gauge configurations with a non-trivial topological charge are suppressed by the presence of the fermion determinant. So the topological charge distribution is strictly zero for a non-zero topological charge. And that means on the other side, if I go back one slide, that mean, all the cumulants vanish and theta dependence becomes trivial. Okay, all derivatives vanish. And this is another way of understanding why, in the presence of massless quarks, theta dependence becomes trivial. Now, on the other hand, the real case that we have in nature is of light quarks. So the mass is not exactly zero. Well, in this case, we can move the theta term by an axial rotation to the mass term, which is non-zero. So you can rotate theta away from the gauge fields, but you get a modification of the mass term. So in some sense, theta is still present in your theory. And this is a way in which theta dependence, which in this case is non-trivial, can be studied using the standard tools of chiral perturbation theory. So the predictions that you have in for full QCD in the presence of light fermions are analytical predictions are mostly based on chiral perturbation theory. Do we have any questions? Can I go on?
Sorry, I'm not sure I understood in the slide before what those B2 before of T coefficients are. I'm sorry.
Well, this is just a parametrization of this Taylor expansion in series of theta. So it's just a definition of this coefficient. I mean,
the sub and the cumulants zero is for what then? The subscript?
The subscript zero is it means that the expectation value is taken at theta equals zero.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, so you are Taylor expanding around the theta equals zero because it is the point where you can do numerical simulations. And so you compute these cumulants at theta equals zero and you obtain the derivatives at the theta equals zero and expand around that. Okay. And this is just one possible definition of these coefficients. I mean, nothing more. Just to give them a name. Now, we know from experimental determinations of CP violating observables, like the electric dipole moment of the neutron, that the value of theta in nature is compatible with zero, and we have an upper bound which is very stringent. It tells us that theta is less than 10 to the minus 10. Okay, so one obvious question is why should we bother about theta dependence at all in QCD? And well, there are several reasons that. And the first is that theta dependence is related, in any case, to the cumulants of the topological charge distribution at theta equals zero. So it is related to the structure of the path integral of QCD at theta equals zero, which is something which enters phenomenology also at theta equals zero. And one example is the Witten-Veneziano relation, which relates the topological susceptibility determined in the pure Young-Mills theory and in the large N limit to the masses of the pseudoscalar mesons, so to the mass of the eta prime. There is a mistake here. One of these eta prime should be the standard eta. So it is the mass of the eta prime squared plus the mass of the eta square minus 2 times the mass of the count square. Okay, so we have this relation which tells you that the expectation, I mean, this is the Witten-Veneziano mechanism to explain the puzzle that you have an eta prime meson with a very large mass compared to the pion masses. And this mechanism explains this value of the mass within the 1 over n expansion, where n is number of colors. And the prediction is from this formula is that the topological susceptibility in Curie-Young Mills and in the Lagrange limit should be 180 MeV to the fourth. I mean, if you just put phenomenological numbers into this formula. Okay, so this is just one example which we will discuss in the following. I mean, how lattice results confirm or disprove this this prediction. There are also other reasons, and one reason is why in nature we have theta exactly equal to zero. I mean, is it just a fine-tuning needed, or is there any mechanism which forces theta to be zero? Now, there is a possible mechanism, and which is the Pecheguin mechanism, which invokes the presence of new fields, so in some sense invokes the presence of physics beyond the standard model. And at an effective level, so without entering the details of the ultraviolet formulation of this theory beyond the standard model, at an effective level, this mechanism is described in terms of a new field, which is the axion, whose properties are fixed by theta dependence in QCD. And I mean, this is an important mechanism because axions are among the most popular dark matter candidates. So it is a particularly important issue. So let me remind you how the axion works and why it is related to theta dependence, because I will come back later on this point during the lectures.
So could I ask one question?
Yeah, sure, please.
So as we know, quarks are getting masses, mass corrections, let's say, why chiral condensate. So why we still cannot keep, let's say, for instance, up quark massless, like bare mass, since we don't know what is its Yukawa coupling to Higgs sector. It's not tested experimentally yet. So why we cannot assume that all mass what up quark has is from chiral condensate, for instance?
Well, I mean, if we take QCD as it is, and we compare the masses of the, we compare the results of lattice QCD regarding the determination of hadron masses and their dependence on the quark masses, then I think that you can exclude that you have a zero value for any of the quark masses.
No, it's not important that value is zero or not, because if it's still really small, smaller than, for instance, what we take at the moment in standard model, like theta can still satisfy this value, right? If mass is small, then theta can be still small, like it can still, this mechanism still can work. There is no direct evidence that, for instance, up quark gets up quark mass is whatever it is from Higgs sector. And important is that for this mechanism, that it's precisely this mass is from Higgs sector, not from chiral condensate. So why we assume directly that these masses are, for instance, not from chiral condensate, but from Higgs sector, which is not primary experimental evidence, for instance.
Okay, you mean you should consider the problem of CP violation within the standard model as a whole. So of course you can have several contributions to CP violation in all the sectors of the standard model. So of course, I mean, if you look at it from the point of view that the you should be more careful about determining what is the contribution to CP variation from each term. Of course, this is, this of the action is not just, it's just one possibility, and this effective model that I will show you is what is called usually the PCD action. So, of course, it is something which assumes, it trades in CP variation within QCD, so it's about the strong CP problem. Okay.
Precisely, that's my point. So, this problem exists if quarks are getting masses from Yukawa. That we for sure know for instance, for top and bottom, because that is tested. If quarks are not getting masses from Higgs sector from Yukawa and they are just getting masses from chiral condensate, then for instance, up quark still can rotate away theta to zero. So precisely, that's my question. So how we know precisely that up quark has, let's say, 4QCD bare mass and it's not from dynamically
okay,
from
but,
QCD?
No, but when you say that the quark masses get masses from the condensate, when you compare the hadron spectrum that you measure phenomenologically to the hadron spectrum that is measured from lattice QCD simulations, you can extrapolate the values of the bare of the renormalized quark mass that you have apart from the contribution that they get from the condensate, from the chiral condensate. So you are in that way you are determining the values of the normalized quark mass, and you are not considering the contribution that they get from the condensate. So the result that when you compare with the phenomenology is that the quark masses, it is excluded from this comparison that the normalized quark masses are zero. Okay.
I see. Thank you very much.
But this comes from a non-trivial comparison between the hadron spectrum that you measure by lattice simulations and the hadron spectrum that you observe in nature. Okay, and it is you have to compare and make chiral extrapolations, it's not exactly my field, so I cannot go in more details, but you end up with a predictions for the values of the up and down quark masses, okay, which does not include the contribution from the chiral condensate, and the values that you get are non-zero in this way. Okay.
If I may add something, this is exactly a result of lattice QCD.
Yeah, exactly.
That has found that the up quark mass is not zero from numerical simulations.
Yeah, exactly. Yes, thanks, Pedro. Yeah, that's what I meant. Yeah.
Yeah, I know.
Okay, so in very few words, the idea of the QCD action is the following. This effective Lagrangian has a part which is the standard QCD Lagrangian without the theta term. Now the theta term comes after. Then you have an action field which has just a kinetic term, so it is massless. And this action field is thought to be the Goldstone boson of some exact symmetry, which is spontaneously broken. Okay, so in principle, this action field is a massless field. So you can think of some Mexican hat potential, and the action field is just the field telling you how to rotate on the bottom of this Mexican hat potential. So it has zero mass. But the axion field has also a coupling to the topological charge density, so to GG dual. And this coupling breaks effectively this symmetry. And the coupling is the same as the theta term. So in practice, you have a theta times the GG dual, which is the standard theta term, plus this axion field divided by this FA, which is a coupling constant, which is unknown. I mean, it is one parameter of this effective Lagrangian. And so the GG dual at the end of the story enters the Lagrangian in this combination, I mean, with the multiplied by theta plus the axion field. So this coupling breaks this exact symmetry, and it is like adding a tilt to the Mexican hat, so that the, after the coupling to GG dual, the Mexican hat is gets a tilt. It's like something like this. And now you have a minimum for the effective potential of the axion field in some point here. And the minimum is fixed by the minimum of theta dependence in QCD. I mean, because the at this effective level, the coupling is just to GG dual. So the minimum is achieved if we go back to the predictions that we have for theta dependence. If you remember, we can make some predictions, trivial predictions. And one prediction is that, sorry, I went two slides before. One prediction is that since theta adds an oscillating factor to the functional integral, the z of theta surely decreases as you switch on theta. And that means that the free energy or the vacuum energy increases. So the first term in this Taylor expansion is surely positive, and the minimum is achieved for theta equals zero. Okay, so you can surely say that the minimum is achieved for theta plus the axion field equal to zero. So basically, this coupling and the fact that now the axion field is a dynamical field. So while theta is a parameter of the theory, which is fixed from the beginning and cannot be changed, I mean, it's a parameter of nature. Once you add the axion field can change dynamically and can tune itself so as to set the minimum of the potential. And so you can set an effective theta parameter, which is the sum of theta plus the expectation value of this field, which now takes a zero expectation value because of this symmetry breaking. And so you have a zero effective theta corresponding to the to this minimum, okay? And so the axion field sets dynamically the effective coupling to the topological charge density to zero, just because the free energy as a function of theta has a minimum in correspondence of theta equals zero. But you need a dynamical field to make this. I mean, you cannot do it by with theta alone. So this is the reason why you need to add a new field to your theory, which is the axion field. Okay, so now I cannot go in more details about the theories at the ultraviolet level that could result in this effective theory with an axion. There are several proposed theories, but one important point is that, I mean, once you are convinced of this, now the you can make a prediction for the axion mass, because the axion mass now is just the curvature that you have around the minimum, okay? And the curvature is just given by the quadratic dependence in theta of the vacuum energy. So it is related to the topological susceptibility, okay? Which gives you the quadratic term in the theta expansion of the vacuum energy. It's just this, this curvature here because, again, because the coupling is to GG dual. So the prediction at the end is the effective mass of the axion is proportional to the topological square, the effective squared mass of the axion is proportional to the topological susceptibility divided by this unknown coupling constant, which is Fa squared. Okay, now, as we will see later on, the topological susceptibility in QCD is a function of temperature. So in this way, since the topological susceptibility and theta dependence changes with temperature, you can make a prediction on how the axial mass will change during the evolution of the universe as the temperature cools down during the universe expansion. And you need this information about how the chiral the topological susceptibility depends on the temperature. And one way to extract this information, which is at some point it is non-perturbative, is to make use of lattice QCD simulations. Okay, so this is why lattice QCD simulations have been recently become a hot topic also regarding the QCD axion phenomenology. And now, of course, you don't know still this coupling constant, but in some way you can put constraints which are very useful from a phenomenological point of view if you know precisely how the topological susceptibility depends on the temperature. Okay? So I will come back later to this relation. Do you have any question now?
Yes, one question. You just assumed we have temperature. We can also have a theta term without necessarily having finite temperature, right?
So the theta dependence, I mean, here when we consider the this expansion here, the free energy density in principle can be computed at non-zero theta or at zero theta. So theta dependence can change as a function of temperature. It depends on whether you consider the path integral with a compactified Euclidean time or not. So theta dependence is a function of temperature itself. We'll see that it can be very different if you go from the vacuum to a finite temperature theory. I don't know if I answered the question. I mean,
no, I was just, this is not my field. I was just thinking if whether we need the temperature to go through these things or if it's just more interesting, of course, because of the things you said with temperature. I was just thinking, I mean, looking at the QCD Lagrangian, we can have this theta term and we don't need to talk about temperature, right? In order to, so we can have the, I don't know, open boundary conditions, so don't compactify the time direction and have a theta and study that as well.
Right? No, of course, yes, you are right. I mean, you can, you have theta dependence even at zero temperature. You don't need to add the temperature. But now the point is that from the, I mean, in this case, you actually, when you consider axion phenomenology and its possible effects on cosmology, you have a finite temperature. So in this case, you have to treat the system from the point of view of finite temperature field theory.
Yes, yes, of course. It was just a curiosity. Thank you.
Yeah. But of course, you can also add the theta term if you are not in a thermal theory. Okay, so now I will now review a few predictions that we can make about theta dependence in some specific regimes of QCD. So the first prediction is for finite temperature QCD, so for QCD at high temperature. Now, in principle, what is the idea? We have seen in the quantum mechanical example that if we know the what are the classical solutions with a non-trivial winding number, we can think of integrating around these classical solutions toward the minima. And in the quantum mechanical example, integration can be performed exactly, so we deduce the topological charge distribution exactly. Now the question is whether we can do the same in Young-Mills theories. Now, of course, the answer is that in this case we can only perform a perturbative computation around these classical solutions. So the solutions are non-perturbative themselves. Of course, they are non-trivial fluctuation of the gauge field, so they are non-perturbative. But we can make an integration around these non-perturbative solutions and get a result for their effective action. And the result is the following. I mean, it resembles the classical action of the instantons. If you remember, I mean, the minimum is achieved for 8 pi squared over b squared times the topological charge. So when Q is equal to 1 for a one instanton solution, the minimum is 8 pi squared over b squared. So the result of the integration around the one instanton solution is the exponential of minus 8 pi squared over b squared times a prefactor which depends on the one loop computation. But here, g squared is the running coupling at the instanton scale. So the instantons, these solutions are characterized by a radius of the instanton, which sets a scale of the instanton. You may have instantons of different sizes when you find this class of classical solutions. And the coupling appearing here is the coupling at the scale of the instanton. Okay. So now, of course, this is a perturbative computation, a one-loop computation, which works well only for instantons of small radius by asymptotic freedom, because the coupling is small in that case. And now the prediction is that such instanton, because the coupling is small, are exponentially suppressed and more as the coupling gets closer to zero. Okay, so you have a prediction that small instantons in the theory are strongly suppressed, and it means that since they are strongly suppressed, it means that they are very dilute. I mean, so they have a small radius, they are strongly suppressed, so the probability of finding one instanton is very small. And you can think of a dilute instanton gas approximation. So you can think of an ensemble of instantons where such instantons of small size do not overlap with each other, and they are like a non-interacting gas. Okay, this is usually called the dilute instanton gas approximation. Now, you expect right from the beginning that the approximation will not work, because you may have instantons of any size, and as the radius gets large, the perturbative approximation will become not well defined. And perturbation theory will break down for such instantons where this big approximation will not work. Okay. Indeed, if you look at the prediction for the distribution in size of instantons, it is something like this. So this is the probability of finding according to this one loop computation, of finding one instanton in a volume in this element of four space volume, and with the sides from rho to rho plus the rho, and it goes like the radius of the instanton to the power 11, the number of colors divided by 3 minus 5. So you can see that the, this distribution is strongly suppressed at small values of rho, which corresponds to small instantons, but it is divergent for large values of rho. So it means that you have an infrared divergence, and instantons of large size are instantons which cannot be considered as non-overlapping. So they are in some sense interacting among each other, and the one instanton approximation, where you compute the effective action of a one instanton solution and then you take it as a way to predict the distribution of the topological charge, of course, is expected to break down. So this approximation is not expected to work, apart from one possibility. I mean, the possibility is that in your theory, you have the presence of an effective infrared cutoff, which cuts away the instantons of large size. And one case in which we have such an infrared cutoff is a finite temperature field theory. Okay, because in this case, you have an infrared cutoff, which is set by the extension of the Euclidean temporal direction. Okay, you have this infrared cutoff, and if the temperature is high enough, so larger or much larger than lambda QCD, at some point you expect that this approximation may work, because you just have instantons of size of radius below the inverse of the temperature, and at some point you expect that. You don't know at which temperature, but we expect that at some asymptotic temperature, this description of the path integral as a sum of non-interacting instanton solutions is expected to work at least at asymptotically large temperatures. Okay. So, what is the prediction for theta dependence in this regime? Now, the prediction is similar to the prediction that we had for the quantum mechanical example in the high temperature regime. So if you remember correctly, I can go back to the to that slide, which was the following. I mean, in the high temperature regime, we're just computing the partition function by summing over Q equals 0, 1, and minus 1. And the result was a theta dependence, the free energy proportional to a cosine theta. Okay. Now, the result is the same also in QCD, but it is not so trivial. I mean, sometimes it is. The result also for Young-Mills theories is expressed saying that, okay, we have just Q equals 0, 1, and minus 1 contributing, just because, going back to the... going back to this slide, just because at very high temperature, we just have instantons of very small size, so this G squared is very small, and the instantons are strongly suppressed. So we just had contributions from the trivial topological sector Q equals 0 or from Q equals 1 or minus 1. Actually, this is wrong, because the difference from with respect to the quantum mechanical example is that in a quantum field theory, we have to take the infinite volume limit. So we cannot just say that the topological charge is 0 plus or minus 1, but we have to take into account all topological sectors, because when you go to infinity with the spatial volume, even if the temporal direction is limited, the total volume goes to infinity, so actually you are exploring all topological sectors at the same time. So the argument is less trivial, but in any case, you end with a cosine theta dependence. Now, the argument is the following. In this regime, since the instantons are non-interacting, you have a given probability to have an instanton in your configuration, which is proportional to the four volume. So, and the either the instantons or the anti-instantons can be treated as uncorrelated and non-interacting objects with a Poisson distribution, okay, with an average probability P per unit volume. So the four volume times P gives you the probability, so P is the probability to have one instanton in one unit of volume. So the distribution, probability distribution for having n plus instantons in your four volume is a Poissonian distribution. That means that it is something like 1 over, it is proportional to 1 over n factorial times this Dufour times P elevated to the n, and then you have to add e to the I theta n, which is just the theta term that you are adding in your theory. So basically, this is the probability of having a number n of instantons, which is Poissonian, times e to the I theta n, and then you have the same for the anti-instantons, and the topological charge is given by the difference in the number of instantons and anti-instantons. Now, the two sums can be performed independently because of the assumption of non-interaction. And when you sum this over n, the Poisson distribution, now the normalization constant is missing here in of the Poisson distribution, but it is not relevant. When you sum this from zero to infinity, you end up with the exponential of Dufour times P times e to the I theta n. Okay, so when you add the contribution both from instantons and anti-instantons, you have the following expression that gives you this dependence of the free energy proportional to the cosine of theta. Okay, so the following expression, which is the same that you have from the simple sum over just zero plus minus one. Okay, and but I mean the important point is that this is a prediction that you have at finite temperature in the thermodynamical limit, so in the infinite volume limit, and for very high temperature where you can, it is a statement of the fact that instantons and anti-instantons are non-interacting. While if you look at the same dependence from the point of view that just Q equals zero plus minus one are relevant, you are just saying that this could be true at any temperature in this volume, if the volume is small enough. Okay, so it's completely different statement, and which could be wrong, it could be just the manifestation of a finite volume effect. While in this case, it is a manifestation of an independence of the distribution of instantons and anti-instantons. Now, this functional dependence has, gives you a well-definite prediction for the coefficients appearing in the Taylor expansion, which are the following. So I just go back just to remind how these coefficients are defined. Okay, now if you match this series with the Taylor expansion of the cosine, then you realize that for a dependence like this one, you need B2 to be minus 1 divided by 12, and so on. Okay, Now, this simple computation just tell you what is the dependence of theta. Of course, does not tell you what is the value in front of it, so the topological susceptibility. Or, I mean, the topological susceptibility is just related to the to this coefficient, 2 times Buffon times p, where p is here is the probability of finding one instanton in a four volume unit. So it is not known in this simple model. You can predict it in by perturbation expansion in a perturbative theory. Okay, so if you now assume that the effective action is 8 pi squared divided by g squared, you can get a prediction also for the topological susceptibility, which is the following. I mean, you predict that topological susceptibility is a decreasing function of the temperature, and the perturbative prediction for two light flavors is with a power which is minus 7 point 66, more or less. Okay. But in one important point is that there are two different predictions here. I mean, the functional dependence on theta is just a manifestation of the fact that instantons and anti-instantons are dilute, so they are non-interacting. And that could be true at in a certain range of temperature, okay? This prediction for the topological susceptibility is a purely perturbative prediction, which could be valid in a different range of temperature. So you could have some regime where you have the cosine theta dependence, but still the dependence of the susceptibility on the temperature is not the one that is predicted by perturbation theory in principle. Okay, but nevertheless, the instantons and anti-instantons could be still non-interacting, so you could still have this cosine theta dependence. Do you have any questions?
Yeah, Massimo.
Yeah,
I'm not quite sure that I understood and understand the relation between the scale of the instanton of the temperature. Because, like, if you go to the previous slide, maybe?
Yeah.
So, I mean, if I understood correctly, I'm expecting that for a small radius of the instantons, the probability is going to be suppressed.
Yeah, of course.
But also, then, for high temperature, I expect to be, again, to find... an higher probability to find an instanton. So, like, but I would have expected that the radius of the instantons will depend on the inverse of the temperature.
No, just because I mean, if you have a finite temperature, then the temporal direction of your spacetime is compactified. Okay, so the temporal direction, this is tau. As a finite radius, a finite extension, which is 1 over the temperature. Okay, so you cannot fit in this manifold, which has a compactified direction, instantons with a radius which is larger than 1 over the temperature.
Ah, yes, sure.
Okay. So for very high temperature, the instantons of large size are cut away by this
cutoff. By this cutoff. Yeah. Okay. Yeah. Thank you.
No. Thanks for the question. I mean, it's important to clarify this point. Any other questions? Okay, now I say that this regime, dilute instanton gas approximation, is expected to work at very high temperature. In principle, you don't know what temperature. I mean, for sure, you don't expect it to work at zero temperature, at low temperature, so in the, for the Young-Yeast vacuum. And there is also another reason for that, and it is based on large N considerations, where large N means large number of colors. Now, if you look at the instanton weight, and you think the way the large N limit is taken, so the large N limit is taken according to the so-called Toft scaling, where as you bring the number of colors to infinity, you have to you must take fixed g squared times the number of colors. So it is this scaling variable lambda which is taken fixed. So if you look back at the instanton weight, where you have e to the minus 8 pi squared divided by g squared, rewritten in terms of this scaling coupling lambda, it appears like e to the minus 8 pi squared times the number of colors divided by lambda. So that means that in the large N limit, the effective instanton weight is expected to vanish exactly. Okay, because NC is in this exponent. So according to instanton computations, you expect that in large N limit, you should not have any theta dependence. Now, this is in contrast with expectation from the Witten-Veneziano mechanism for the eta prime mass. So you may expect that this argument does not work, at least at zero temperature or at very small temperature in the confined region, because otherwise the Witten-Veneziano mechanism will not work. I mean, you will have a trivial theta dependence. Instead, you expect that, let me go back to two slides, that the topological susceptibility for pure Young Mills in the large N limit must be this finite value. Okay, 180 MeV to the fourth. So of course, you don't expect, as for the previous argument, that instanton computations works at low temperature. Anyway, based on that, if you look at the paper by Witten, the original paper in which he also proposed the Witten-Veneziano mechanism for the eta prime mass, Witten makes also an ansatz regarding theta dependence. Basically, he considers that instanton computation cannot work, and instanton computations will lead you, I mean, if you your vacuum is described as a sum of instantons and anti-instantons, then you expect that the dependence is a dependence on theta, but Witten makes the following argument that if you look at the Lagrangian of QCD expressed in terms of theta, then the way theta appears in the Lagrangian, if we consider again this scaling variable lambda as you take the large N limit, theta appears in the in this combination, if you substitute g squared with lambda, you have a theta over nc, which appears in the QCD Lagrangian. So an ansatz made by Witten is that the natural variable is theta over nc, and this combined with the request that since the number of degrees of freedom scales like nc squared, I mean the number of gluons that you have in the theory scales like nc squared, so we expect that the free energy or the vacuum energy is proportional to nc squared. You make an ansatz that the free energy as a function of theta is nc squared times a scaling function of this theta bar, which is theta over nc. And the ansatz by Witten to guarantee a non-trivial theta dependence even at zero temperature is that this scaling variable, this scaling function f bar, has a non-trivial dependence on this theta bar. Okay, now if you make substitute these answers. So you write this your free energy density as nc squared times a power series in this scaling variable theta bar, and you compare with the standard way of writing the Taylor expansion in terms of theta. Then you realize that according to these answers for matching the powers, we expect the topological susceptibility reaches a constant, and is of order zero as a function of NC, while the corrections, the B2, B4, and so on coefficients, should scale like inverse powers of NC. So should be subnominant in the 1 over NC expansion, and should vanish as you go in the NC, in the large NC limit. Okay? So this is a large N scaling, which is expected to work if you require that the topological susceptibility in the large N limit be different from zero. Okay, so that you have a non-trivial theta dependence in the large N limit, as required by the Witten Menetziano mechanism. And the prediction is also that since all the corrections vanish, is that in the large N limit, the topology, the theta dependence becomes purely quadratic, which, if you remember from the quantum mechanical model, means that the distribution is purely Gaussian. And moreover, you predict that at theta equal pi and also other corresponding values, 3 pi and so on, you have a phase transition just because of the properties of periodicity and of the fact that f of theta is even in theta. You expect phase transitions in the large N limit at least at theta equal pi. Okay, so these are the predictions from theta dependence, from theta dependence coming from the large N considerations. Now, let me say, first of all, that in the case of QCD and of Feyerabend's theories, these large N predictions are just what we said above. So our predictions regarding the scaling of the coefficients of the theta function as a function of NC. We have other models like CPN models in two dimensions where you can also make a prediction for the coefficients that we have in front of this leading order dependence. So in that case, you can compare in the following, I will compare the results of lattice simulations for different values of NC with this prediction, and I will show you that lattice simulations confirm this scaling at low temperature in the large N limit. In other QCD-like theories, like CPN models, you can have a quantitative also comparison with the coefficients of this large N expansion. This is one observation. The other observation is that, if you have a dependence on a scaling variable like theta over NC, if you compare with what you obtain in the instanton computation, in the instanton computation, you obtain a dependence on theta, not on theta over NC, okay? Because you just have a gas of instantons which have an integer charge. So you end up with a periodic function of theta, a smooth function, okay? So now, since you have a dependence on this scaling variable theta over NC, the question is whether this is an expression of the fact that the effective degrees of freedom at low temperature are not integer charge configurations, but instead configurations with a fractional value of the topological charge, sometimes called instanton quarks, okay, which are fractional topological charge. Now, there is a prediction also from lattice simulations regarding this. The result is that if this degrees of freedom with fractional charge have a role in the dynamics, for sure they cannot be considered as weakly interacting. I mean, I will compare the results of lattice simulations with this possibility, which is stated here. Okay. Do you have any questions?
Maybe I have a question.
Yeah, sure.
I know you said this in the last lecture also, but this functional form where it has this p-nodal sort of singularity, I mean, because of periodicity, you have this corner shape. Why would we call it a phase transition? I mean, just looking at the functional form.
Because it is, I mean, if you are, it is a quantum phase transition. At zero temperature, it is a quantum phase transition, but also at finite temperature, it is a phase transition. It is just because the a first derivative of the free energy is discontinuous.
Okay, but is that also like a first order phase transition then? That's also like a first order phase transition, right?
Yeah, it is also for a standard phase transitions, yes. For the quantum mechanical example, you just said the transition at zero temperature, so for that reason it was a quantum phase transition. Now, in this case, it could be also that the it keeps also at zero temperature. So you could also have this discontinuous derivative also at zero temperature. So it could be also a standard phase transition.
I see. Okay.
So it is just for the quantum mechanical model that it happens just at zero temperature. Actually, for sure, I mean, in the large n limit, this scaling must be true in the whole confined phase. So even at finite temperature, but till you are in the confined phase, you expect this scaling to hold. So you expect a true phase transition at non-zero temperature, but as a function of theta. Even at finite temperature.
Okay,
fine. So, last possible prediction comes from chiral perturbation theory, and this regards full QCD with light flavors. So, I will not go into the details, but I mean, the reason why you can make such a computation is that when we have light flavors, you can perform an axial rotation and move the theta term to the mass step. So then you can make use of standard chiral perturbation theory. And the first computation was made by Di Vecchia and Veneziano in the 80s. You can make a prediction for the vacuum energy. So this is basically it is the free energy at zero temperature. And the prediction is the following at the leading order. And from this dependence, you can derive the derivatives computed at theta equals zero. So you can derive the topological susceptibility and then B2, B4, and so on. I mean, you can make a Taylor expansion and match with the Taylor expansion that I wrote before. And the prediction depends on the ratio of the quark masses. Okay, so this Z equals 0.48 is the physical one, in the one that is extracted from lattice QCD simulations that we mentioned before. Instead, this Z equals 1 is the case of degenerate flavors, which is something which is sometimes taken as an approximation. And you can see that the topological susceptibility does not differ much, and the depredation is for a topological susceptibility, the fourth root of the topological susceptibility, which is around between 70 and 80 MeV. And you also have predictions, the following predictions for the B2 coefficients. So I'm reporting these values here because I will compare them with the lattice computations later on. Okay. An interesting point is that this is the value you should use because this is the prediction for QCD with the dynamical fermions. So it is the value that you should use if you want to make a prediction for the axion mass, for the value of the axion mass today, I mean approximately at zero temperature, so in the vacuum. And it is the following one. I mean, it comes out as a function of this inverse coupling constant. And this prediction can be used to make a comparison also with, or to make a suggestion to experiments. But I will come later on also on this point. Now, I finished with my introductory theoretical material. Now, let me make a list of the main questions that we would like to understand by lattice simulations. So, of course, we would like to check the Lagrange predictions for Poiret mills. So, we would like to check by lattice simulations whether the Wittmann-Menetziano formula gives a correct description of the phenomenology and also the scaling of the coefficients. And of course, one can play the game of checking this also for QCD-like theories like the CPM models. Then we would like, one would like to understand whether these Lagrange predictions turns to a Dirac instanton gas approximation regime at some value of the temperature. We know that at some asymptotic value of the temperature, the instanton computation should work. But the only way to know at which temperature it starts to work is to make a non-perturbative computation from first principles. And lattice simulations are, of course, the ideal tool to do that. And in doing this, we would like to understand whether there is any relation between the transition from large N behavior to a Dirac instanton gas approximation as any relation with the confinement transition. And regarding the high temperature regime, one would like to understand if lattice simulations can give useful predictions for axion cosmology. And finally, one would like to consider also the theta dependence of other observables. For instance, when I told you that we have a very stringent upper bounds on theta coming from the experimental measure of the electric dipole moment of the neutron, this upper bound essentially is based on the fact that the dipole moment of the neutron, since it is it would violate CP symmetry, must be proportional to some constant C times theta. So it is an odd dependence on theta. So as you switch on theta, then you allow for a non-zero dipole moment of the neutron, electric dipole moment for the neutron. So if you measure zero experimentally, you can set an upper bound for theta. But in order to set the upper bound, you need to know this constant C. Now, this constant C usually is deduced from dimensional considerations, I mean, qualitative considerations. I mean, you just consider what relevant constants could be entering this constant C. But of course, also in this case, the first principle tool, the natural first principle tool, is to make a non-perturbative determination of this C constant by just measuring it by lattice simulations. Okay, so a determination of the dependence of the electric dipole moment of the neutron on the theta by lattice simulations would allow to make a more quantitative the upper bound that we set on theta. Okay, so this is one example of why it could be very interesting. And of course, this particular topic, I mean, the determination of the electric dipole moment of the neutron, is one of the hot topics in lattice QCD simulations today. Now, this was the list of interesting questions. Now, let me make a list of the main technical problems or main issues that we have to face when we try to study topology on the lattice. Well, the first issue regards the how you discretize and how you determine the topological charge and the cumulance of the topological charge by lattice simulations. So we have to choose a discretization of the observable of the topological charge. We can be either a gluonic or fermionic discretization, but then you have to take care of renormalization or make use of smoothing techniques in order to suppress them. And a non-trivial question is whether you can do this systematically. I mean, there are several possible different definitions of topological charge, and so different ways of measuring the topological susceptibility by lattice simulations. The question is whether the different determinations give you consistent results. And the answer is yes. I mean, now we have several determinations, and I will show you that all the methods that I will review give you a consistent result for the topological susceptibility. Then another issue, what is the control on the continuum extrapolation? And of course, I mean, part of the control on the continuum extrapolation of the results regarding theta dependence is included in the comparison that I will make for the topological susceptibility in pure gauge. But then an interesting thing is that the continuum extrapolation is much more difficult when you consider a theory with dynamical fermions. And this is strictly related to the fact that when you have dynamical fermions and light dynamical fermions, then theta dependence is in some sense suppressed because of the determinant, as I explained to you before. And but if you use a discretization of the Dirac operator, which has bad chiral properties, then these bad chiral properties will reflect in the way that this suppression on the topological charge is effectively made. So you may have strong lattice artifacts in the presence of fermions. Then another issue is if you are interested to compute the higher order cumulants, which are related to the theta to the fourth, this is a difficult problem from a numerical point of view because you need to measure some tiny deviations from a Gaussian distribution, okay, if you just have access to theta equals zero simulations. So in some sense, you need to add a source. I mean, it is useful to add a source like an explicit theta term in the path integral. This, of course, is not possible directly because you have a sign problem, but you can play some game with an imaginary values of theta and then make use of analytic continuation. And I will discuss this in the following. And finally, one important point regards the algorithmic issues. I mean, as you approach the continuum limit, you may have a situation in which your algorithm is not able anymore to switch from one topological sector to the other. So you have what is called a critical slowing down of topological modes that makes you algorithm non-ergodic. And another problem is that if you are at very high temperature, where the topological susceptibility is strongly suppressed, then it may be that the average value of Q squared is very small, and you need a very large statistics to correctly evaluate it with a reasonable error. So this is a list of problems that now I will discuss more in detail that regards more specifically the lattice formulation of the theory. So, do you have any questions?
One question. I was just thinking, you said that with the small mass, we can rotate away the theta term to the mass term. Now you are talking about discretization. I thought if you have something like Wilson fermions, massless Wilson fermions, could you, I mean, is there also interest in maybe rotating the theta term to the Wilson term? Does this make any sense? Is this done or does this work?
Well, of course, if you have Wilson fermions, you have mainly the chiral properties of Wilson fermions are not so good because you have an additive normalization of the mass step. So you have a problem in that case. I mean, if you make a chiral rotation, your fermions, even if you set the mass to zero, in the bare mass to zero, the axial rotation is not a symmetry of the theory. So, I mean, of course, you can rotate it to the effective mass term of the Wilson term, but I don't know if it is useful. I mean, maybe yes, but I cannot really answer. I mean, this has been tried.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah.
Other questions?
I have a question, Massimo. Yeah. There is some other observable in which is possible to see theta dependence, apart that neutron magnetic moment, a dipole moment.
You mean other observables?
Yes, in which is possible to see experimentally theta dependence.
From the experimental point of view. Well, I think you can, yeah, there are similar observables like the neutral dipole moment of the neutron, but of course this is the maybe the easiest one to be measured experimentally. So I think you can think of other observables, but the electric dipole moment is just the easiest one to be measured. I don't know if there are other experiments looking at other observables, which of course you can find. Of course, they must be all, in every case, the CPO, the observables.